Have you heard of Gone with the Wind? We actually shot that on Super 8.
When I was a kid, I remade...
Jurassic Park, Matrix,
Spider-Man, and then I made my own series called Hitman, where my sister was my accomplice, but she was killed, and so to avenge her death, I had to go kill the main mob boss.
We should include these as DVD extra special features. Extra special features.
Super special.
Deep cuts.
My action line was goodbye, goodbye forever, and I would...
Feel free to wander, feel free to curse, whatever. We run it uncut.
Cool.
Fuck, piss, shit.
No words that we can't.
Big mouth, ass, tard, dick.
Where did this story start for you?
Matt?
Oh.
I'm pretty sure you were the progenitor.
I had a nightmare. I guess it came from a nightmare that I had about going to this family reunion in Nebraska, which actually happens every year. My family's from Nebraska. The film was shot on the farm that they live in.
Wow.
I had a nightmare that I was at that annual family reunion, and there was a big misunderstanding, and I was accused of something untoward, but I don't actually remember what it was. I just awoke with this feeling of being terribly misunderstood and unable to use logic to defend myself, or feeling like the more I tried to defend myself, the worse it got. Mm-hmm. And it was just an incredibly visceral and lingering feeling. Usually dreams evaporate pretty quickly from your body, but this one didn't. So I thought that I would try to recreate a scene that would do that to an audience. But obviously the story is different than just that dream. Yeah.
So did you ever figure out what the dream was about?
What it was that I was accused of?
No, that war in your what emotionally
oh, oh,
it was.
Oh, where it was based
was
on.
Was there a reason you were so...
You know what? Sometimes a dream is just a dream, I think. Yeah.
Okay.
What was it Freud said?
No,
sometimes...
it's going back to your childhood somehow. You were loved as a kid.
I don't know. I think I was... I really care what people think of me.
Hmm.
Yeah, I care how I appear in people's minds more than I admit. So maybe the most uncomfortable thing I could imagine is being thought by someone else to be something that I'm not.
So was that a big part of what you and Logan worked out for the character? Because the character has a lot of quiet moments where he's really just being introspective. Was that a conversation you had?
Well, wait, why don't we talk about the first time that first conversation we had?
I guess, okay, so the casting process for this was about a year. I had first met Matt, I guess 2 years ago now, is that? And I had read the script, didn't know what was going to happen, and they just said, you're going to have this general meeting with this director, Matt. And so in my mind, I'm thinking, oh, it's just going to be a basic meeting, you know, talk about what you have done in the past, you know, what you thought of the script, any ideas. But instead, Matt took it in a whole different direction, where he first asked me what was the worst thing that I've ever done in my life. And he...
Nice to meet you. What's the worst thing you were doing?
Nice to meet you. How are you doing?
It's not quite as intense.
And he tells me the worst thing he ever did in his life to then make me feel comfortable about the situation. And then we have a improv, about a 20-minute improv, where I'm confronting my mother, telling her that I have done something terribly wrong in a sexual manner. And
The thing that from my end, at least, that I was like trying to do was to... Initially, we started out talking about the character and why... I was asking you, like, why you think he did this thing in
exactly.
the story.
Yeah, yeah.
And you were trying to rationalize it. And then, like, I tried to do it as subtly as possible, but in the conversation slip into... Instead of he, I started saying you.
Oh, right.
And then,
refer to yourself as I instead of he.
Yeah, usually people, when you just start saying you to them instead of why does this character do this, and then you just say like, when you did this, did you think that? Usually people will just like start doing it. Mm. Actors especially, I think. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people get really uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Logan.
I mean, like, I was really uncomfortable, but I mean, we made it work.
Well, because like, we were also going like way off the borders of the page. Like, so I was kind of asking him essentially, although we didn't discuss it before, to like, to begin to improv like off between the lines, mm-hmm. and start to extrapolate. And I was kind of getting ideas for the story and the character when you were talking.
Yeah. And I mean, I guess like once we had been casting, because then that was like a year later, we finally got the movie. And prior to that too, I was just like, this is never going to happen. This was the craziest interview I've ever experienced. And I don't know what to generate from what this guy is trying to do, but we're going to try to work it out. And then finally, after a year, it had come back to me, and I had read a completely different draft in a way. And then once you and I started conversing outside of that initial casting period, then I started to kind of understand what this story was about, what you were trying to portray, and, you know, how we could make this a story of innocence, but also self-discovery, I guess, in a way.
Yeah. I think that we did talk a lot about, like, exactly what is going on inside a 17-year-old's mind, and about this sort of, like, precarious position that maybe a 17-year-old sits on, where he or she thinks that they know a lot, but they really haven't begun to know anything. Mm. And that's certainly what I was like when I was 17, and I had a really ridiculously undramatic upbringing, and I had no life experience really. And I would always like make a joke that I wish I had been had been like abused or something, so I'd have some like more material.
Because I'm the same way, and I make jokes like that. I say, oh, my mom referred to me as her ashtray or something like that. That's definitely not true, but it's one of those things where, yeah.
We did. Like,
Smoked? Oh my God.
I remember doing this art piece, which was a fake counseling session for artists of non-abusive families when we are 17, maybe we're like juniors or seniors in high school, we're reading all of these like great writers, we're listening to all of this great music, we think we're really getting in touch with ourselves, but we don't know shit. And that was sort of like very important to me, that this 2-day period that this movie unfolds in was like the moment where you realize you don't know shit.
Yeah. Don't know shit, but also, I mean, he doesn't know anything, but yet he, I think, comes out of the movie with a better understanding of where everybody else is coming.
That is something that you and Robin brought, though. That's nice. Like, that was not actually initially in my, that was in my writing of the story. That was like totally came out of discussions with you and Robin about,
right.
Oh, he also like gains this understanding of his family. Mm-hmm. I'm glad that that came out. But I had kind of like a much more negative like
where
outlook
just,
on
you don't
coming
know
of
shit
age.
You're never gonna know shit.
Well, no, I thought like coming of age was this like incredibly like destructive moment when you all of these like pillars that you built your understanding of who you are on get totally demolished.
Yeah.
And perhaps something like more profound can be built out of the rubble of that, but that like is I think we leave you in the story like way that is yet to be seen, you know, exactly how he's going to move forward.
Yeah.
Well, is the subtext or the text that's subtextual movable in this story? I mean, you may have given a spoiler earlier in saying, you know, what's the worst thing you've ever actually done? Because in the movie, it's not 100% clear.
It's not 100% clear what
happened in the barn.
Right. Right. That's like I'm not sure exactly how much we're allowed to discuss.
Yeah. I mean, what do you mean that like we don't have to discuss it? That it, I think that that's all to the audience to figure that out. Like that's an
right.
Well, but I think that's how the movie's made. But it, I'm not sure that you're saying that you feel like that was your intention.
That
things be missed. I mean, there are two major moments towards the end, and then towards the beginning, where what actually happened is debatable.
Right.
There's another one that's a little debatable, but it's something else going on.
I would say that I am interested in that debate being had. I have my very specific opinions about what happened in both of those instances.
As myself. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And but we also really wanted to leave open the possibility. We wanted the story to support multiple interpretations so that different people in the audience could really debate each other about what they thought happened.
Well, and what's great about that too is like having shown it to some people that are close to me, they said that when one incident happened in the film, they believed that I was the victim of a misunderstanding. But once they saw, you know, another event come into play, then their mindset of who I was completely flipped by the end of it. And
interesting. We should talk about that later.
Yeah, I'll tell you.
I've heard, like, this, but everybody, what I think is really cool is that literally everybody I talk to has a unique opinion about who these people are and what really happened. None of their opinions, everyone holds their opinion like very strongly, and nobody is usually people feel confident enough to jump to that conclusion given the information in the story. But I like to just let people talk about it amongst themselves, because I have my idea, but my idea is not better or more interesting than your idea.
Did you need to make the film on the basis of your idea, or was that...
Yeah.
So you guys matched ultimately when you... By the time you shot, you had a minute...
Yeah, I mean, did we? I mean, I think... Yeah, we had a discussion of where we thought it went. But I think we kind of...
I think it's actually it, right? More... I think we were pretty close. Mm-hmm. Like, it's actually more of an interesting conversation to speak about the Robin and Josh's characters, because they... It potentially could be that they have different understandings. Those two characters have different understandings of what happened.
Mm. Yeah.
So between I had them. A private... What?
Between them.
Yes. Yeah. So I had a private conversation about what happened in the backstory. In history, so I had a private conversation with Josh and a private conversation with Robin, and then a conversation with them both together. Mm. It's so difficult to speak about this without actually saying what the story is about, but that's...
Yeah. Well, but okay, so here's the interesting thing too, is we did actually have to have the same perspective because you were shooting it in such a way that was in my eyes.
Yes.
And like, that's the thing, like every other character surrounding me could have their different opinions. However, like him and I, the camera, the audience has to kind of be on my side and know what's going in my head the entire time, because it is in the perspective of my character.
Well, it's funny, I don't think there's a problem. I mean, even for spoilers or whatever, I don't think it's an issue to like discuss what happens in the movie, like what's in the on screen.
Yeah.
The question of what happens in the moments where we don't, as the audience, know what happened exactly,
right,
is what I guess the conversation that comes out of the movie is.
Right.
It's like the Sixth Sense. You kind of want to go back and look at those scenes again and see if there's a clue.
I would say that Robin, we've been speaking about the project for a year and a half in incredible detail. And there was a interpretation that she was very surprised to hear people came up with. And then she watched the film again last week and she was like, oh my God, it's totally there. I didn't realize that was there.
Yeah.
It feels very satisfying to have created something that like, it seems to be like a petri dish for like these stories to spin off in different directions.
Well, you know, I've only seen the movie in isolation myself on a couch, you know, so I haven't had the experience of discussing it with anybody else who saw it. Yeah. So it's kind of interesting to think that there are going to be, you know, 10 different interpretations
that are happening. It's cool because seeing everybody else's subtext too and like what they're going to take away from it. And then having the discussion with the person afterwards, being like, this is what I think happened, seeing, oh, how crazy somebody else's imagination can go. When it's like, we gave them the structure for that, and then they go off in their own mind into this entirely different tangent.
Right.
It's really kind of refreshing to see.
One of my, big goals, and, you know, I'll leave it up to you to decide if we've achieved it or not, but, like, was... to implicate the audience in so much as that they bring a lot of predilections to the viewing process. Mm-hmm. And the first time I thought of this was when watching The White Ribbon, and as I walked away, I thought, are these children really to blame, or is it actually the audience that is really to blame? Because it's really about our tendency as people to point the finger at anyone and blame anyone without the full amount of information.
Right.
So in that sense, I wanted to request that the audience insert their own fears into the story to make them play an active role and to hopefully in the end put a mirror in front of them and say to what degree are am I responsible in the same way that these characters are responsible for blaming someone without fully knowing the truth.
It sounds like you're going to have a bit of an experience, I'm not completely blanking on the movie, the name of the movie, but the movie with the girl in the chicken restaurant who ends up naked and raped.
Compliance.
Oh.
It sounds like that's it's coming your way. At Sundance, at least.
In what way?
Well, Compliance is a little more...
Well, yeah, no, but I'm curious. I'm curious. I think that there are similarities, and then there are not similarities.
Well, there are literal things about Compliance that are more overt that people, I think, debated whether they were good or bad, or they liked it, or it was irritating, or whatever.
Right.
Whereas this is a much more gentle piece, generally speaking. It's not quite as in your face, but it leaves you with that same feeling of churn about what really happened in the movie,
I think, right?
What it meant.
I feel like Compliance that connected kind of to that. Came more for a literal standpoint, though.
I just have been watching video recordings of Q&As at Sundance that have been kind of
controversial,
and because I wanted to know really, because I heard the Compliance Q&A got wild or whatever, and I wanted to see what it was really about, and it was somebody who felt that the film was gratuitous in its use of the Dreema, her body, which I do not feel like is similar in this
not an
film.
Issue with this movie at all. No.
But I think that it could be similar in that it is potentially equally as bleak. But I don't. But yeah. Theirs doesn't end on a song.
Right. So. Right. No. Yeah. Exactly. We got Queen on our side. Yeah.
No, I mean they're very different movies. I don't mean to compare that way. But and you are certainly completely as a filmmaker completely respectful of the little girl who is put in that position. It's not like we've seen a few movies at Sundance where it was a little creepy at times to watch the movie. This movie never goes to that place, so that's good. But it's that same kind of the audience walking out and not knowing quite what to.
Right.
Assuming they know the answer, then having a conversation with their friend and going, wait a minute, that's completely different than what I thought.
My thinking of that is there's a lot of films, Precious, I can't think of any other examples right now, that deal with abuse, and then wrap it up in a neat little bow at the end. Mm. And I'm not dissing Precious, but I'm kind of dissing Precious because... because I think that the whole point of these issues is that you can't wrap them up in a neat little bow at the end, and actually leaving the situation where at the end of the film where the bad guy does not get their due is actually closer to life. Well, and I could make a case for how that's more respectful.
I would say what's good about this film, too, is seeing that it's not like we're wrapping it up. Everybody had their own issues. Like, once one issue comes into play, then all these other issues start to unfold. And what's interesting about that, it's like, yeah, it is kind of like this butterfly effect or domino effect in a way of like, one thing happens, another thing is going to happen. So never will anything be resolved. And I mean, there will be resolutions that come along the way. However, one thing is just going to always affect another. And so I think that that's really great, because in this film, it shows things that happened with me and Molly, you know, made Robin's character feel one way, made Josh's character feel another way. Mm-hmm. And so it's seeing how people deal with that instead of wrapping it up and going, oh, what a beautiful movie at the end. Oh, that tied up just so perfectly.
Well, you know,
but see, at the end of the movie, I wouldn't say there was a villain in this movie.
There was a what?
I don't think there... For me, watching the movie at the end, I don't say this is the bad guy in this movie.
Absolutely.
Yeah. At all.
No,
absolutely.
Yeah,
just... That's... The bad guy is our inability to communicate.
Yeah.
Which I feel is much more in line with like the problems, though way less dramatic in my actual family.
Mm-hmm.
And like maybe in the country.
The real villain.
No, it's. I mean, it's like we.
Democracy.
Yeah.
No, but like when I, you know, I'm obviously like much more liberal than the rest of my family, and there are topics that we can't discuss,
mm-hmm.
And there are topics that when we do discuss, we just like talk right by each other.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. and that's like the problem. Yeah.
It was really cool. It was interesting for me because I grew up in a family much like Matt's mother and his upbringing, where my entire family is from Midwestern Kansas. And so a family reunion like this was very close to home. And so being able to make a film that was kind of in the same realm of where I was brought up. I mean, you know, like you said, not as dramatic as what Ryder goes through and whatnot. But it was interesting because this story plays into very similar themes that my mother has gone through as a child, and she had said that to me. And when she read the script, I was very nervous at first to kind of let them read this and tell them what I was going to be doing. But what my mom actually ended up saying was like, this is a movie kind of similar into what I dealt with as a child. And I was like, wow, that really changed the perspective for me. And it made me feel good that I was doing something that would be kind of inspirational in that manner of.
Yeah. I was really surprised how many people, women mostly, have come up to me and told me that they had a very similar experience in their childhood. And have not really ever spoken about it. And I did not, when writing it, realize how common that was.
It's why, I mean, I think it's one of the great blights in our society that, you know, women of other age, older, of all kinds of ages, but that, you know, women are sexualized in this country in a way that they almost all are and almost never talk about or feel free to talk about in public. It's very difficult.
But even so, like, not even just the whole women's standpoint, I think we don't realize that, like, children are sexual creatures as well. And, like, I think this film kind of portrays a misunderstanding of an adult coming in through a perspective of, I've known what I've gone through and I see that, and then watching what a child has done with another child or something and blowing it out of proportion. You know, I think, you know.
Or not. I mean, it depends
on. Yeah.
That's up to
the punchline.
And that's for the viewer.
So did the year between the time you first met and the time you actually did the movie and you read another version of the script change the experience for you as an actor? I mean, you're growing up as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that year had been a giant.
He's 35, actually. He just looks.
Yeah, I'm a 35.
You're 35?
Like he's 17.
Yeah, I had two kids in that year between and.
You know what? Stranger things have happened. Yeah. So you know.
No, but I would say yeah. I mean, I did a lot of growing up in that year. You know, I'm in my first very serious relationship, and that started when this movie kind of came to be, and then I was working a little bit more and just getting a little bit more seasoned in what I wanted to do and getting out of this old career that I kind of started as a kid and trying to make my way into the films and stuff that I really wanted to generate.
Have you seen I'm in the Band? He's great. I'm in the Band.
Let's not talk about I'm in the Band.
Okay, forget it. We can edit that.
Yeah. Cut. Edit that one out. Cut. I'm the Band didn't happen. Disney X what? That's what we're going to say.
If it makes you feel any better, the guy who was in here last was in Twilight. So.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
He was happy not to talk about it either.
Yeah. Well, you know, yeah. But I mean, you know, I'm not saying that that was a bad part of my life. It was a great part of my life. But the process of all of that, it was good that I kind of had changed as a person. And then once we reconnected and got things going, then... Yeah, I felt really open to this opportunity, and I just was like, let's go out into Nebraska, into a town of 1,000 people, and let's just create. We have open range to do whatever we want, which was really, really cool and satisfying in that way. And
it sounds kind of cliche to say it was the Wild West, but it was the Wild West.
It was the Wild Midwest.
Nothing. Mm-mm. To not like a no nothing. If something broke, there was like nothing within the closest like camera rental house was LA, I guess.
Yeah. There was nothing stopping us and everything stopping us, if that makes sense.
How long was shoot?
21 days.
So that's tight.
With a crew of very minimal crew.
I don't know. Maybe 20?
Yeah.
I don't know. I had like postpartum amnesia.
Every extra was a like person that lived
resident
in the town.
Resident of Loop City, Nebraska.
Yeah. We had some Loop City actors as well that did great jobs.
Yeah.
It was really fun kind of working with them. The best one was the twins in the film that are my twin cousins. It was really great getting to kind of work with them in a way with their perspective of never, ever seeing or being a part of a film whatsoever and kind of being able to pull a performance off of that based off of like the improvs and stuff.
Yeah, we specifically did not want them to see their lines. We let them see the script, but we changed their lines in the script so that they would never... The first time they said their lines was you would try to improv with them to get them to say their line. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It was great. Yeah. We would, I would almost like, to get them a little angry at me or something, I would throw some like insults at them.
Yeah. We had like.
And then by the insult, that would maybe hopefully generate some sort of performance that we were looking for.
Yeah.
And I think it did. I think they're great in the film, actually. And everybody in the Loop City realm did a really great job. And you could kind of just tell that they're in the stance of what the fuck is going on, but that's what the film was too in that situation.
You just reminded me of the Taylor Swift. I guess you could call it a trick or a method, Ursula, who plays Molly in the film, is really into Taylor Swift.
Yeah.
And
the biggest Taylor Swift fan.
Yeah. And so we started this narrative on like the first day that she got there about how you and Taylor had dated in high school.
Right. Yeah.
And
then we'd had this long lasting relationship and we just broke up with each other, but we were maybe getting back together. But she didn't even care about that. We just made this giant backstory for ourselves. What she cared about is that I would potentially have Taylor Swift's number.
And so we put my phone number in his phone as Taylor Swift. And
removing Taylor Swift's real phone number, I assume.
Right. Because
though that one is actually that one's Matt Sobel now, so it's weird. Like Matt Sobel calls him all the time to booty call.
Yeah, Matt Sobel always tells me to shake it off. Or something.
but like it would just be is so subtle. Like if we were shooting a long day and I felt like it, you know, long days are harder on children, and we needed to get like the energy up. I would just kind of like saunter over to Logan and be like, just like, let's mention something about Taylor.
Right.
Like right before we go into the next take. And then he would be like, oh, that you know, that reminds me of this story Taylor used to tell me. And then she'd be like, what? And I'd be like, action.
Yeah, action. And then you saw the excitement.
Yeah, exactly. And also because she was enamored with Taylor, was by proxy enamored with you.
Right.
Which is the important thing, mm-hmm. because she has to be enamored with.
Yeah.
So
we're gonna have a special thanks to Taylor Swift. And the
right? Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe she'll give you a song for the opening of the credits
Come
or something.
On.
So I mean, obviously a good trick to play with a young actress.
Technique. I think it's a technique.
Okay. Yeah. But I mean, did you dance around the the subtext that was going on, or did you ever broach it in any way? Or
Gave a. A very toned down description of what we were going to, what this darker subtext of the story was to her.
And her parents, I guess?
Yeah.
We're having a long conversation, longer conversation?
Later. The conversation was between me and the parents about how to describe it to her.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so you just figured out a place that was safe enough for her and not awkward. You don't sexualize her in the movie, but... there's stuff, potentially going on. There's something going on there. So,
yeah. I mean, that was a, that was the discussion between the parents and I. And we found ways to describe it to her that we felt were accurate and not, did not ask too much of her. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what were the, as an actor, in your character, and you're in almost, seem not every frame of the film, but pretty much every sequence of the film, almost. I mean, what were the hard things for you? Not everything, and nothing is easy, no doubt. But
yeah.
Was there anything that was like was it more difficult to be moody and alone on camera, or was it more difficult to deal with the other actors? Was it?
Oh wow, I would say, at times it was the subtle stuff that really I would say would be the most difficult, and. The ones that were always like so depleting to me was the scenes between Robin and I, and I think it was because there's such a battle between us in the movie of like, I'm this person that wants to grow up, but mom, has always seen her child the way that she needs to and coddles me and stuff, and I'm retaliating against that. And so I think that those scenes were very, very difficult because they had to be structured in a very intricate way. And like the core emotion of some of the film was in scenes like that. And things that like the river scene or like the scene at the table with the Keith and his family, like those just came so naturally to me because there was such this like awkward... battle that was going on between these characters, mm-hmm. and it just made it fun because it was loose and improv-y in a way where it was typical conversations of people, whereas the stuff with Robin and myself was more of like the mother-son dynamic.
Those were very like intricately rehearsed, mm-hmm. I'd say, and the stuff at Keith's house was more like one emotional beat for the whole,
right? Yeah,
like
me and Robin went through such an arc together, we had to portray that on screen, and so we constantly had to be communicating what was going on, what we were thinking in each scene and each beat, even, because one line in one of those scenes can completely change the dynamic of what that person is thinking. So we had to completely rehearse and...
Yeah, I think that, like, for me, what was, like, important in those scenes was this thing that I sort of... I'm an only child and went through with my own mother, which is we both knew... So being an only child, and maybe if you're an only child and you're listening, you'll agree, you're very, like, you are coddled and tickled and, like, loved... a little bit like too closely for too long.
Mm-hmm.
And both of us as your characters in the film, like knew that sort of close relationship was going to need to get was going to need to break at some point, but neither one wanted to be the one to say, now's the point where we are going to stop being like mommy and...
Right. We're going to treat each other like
mommy and righty.
Yes. It's all handshakes.
Sort of want like it to be an understanding that you both come to at the same time and then say, now we are adults and we're going to have an adult relationship. But it doesn't work out so cleanly like that. Yeah. So like someone gets their feelings hurt. And in this case, it's mom.
Yeah, yeah.
Sometimes you just have to say, mom, I don't want you here.
That's right.
One of the most painful, I think amongst the lines in the movie, that's one of the most painful.
Yeah, it's weird though, because like it would have been easier to play that scene as like just a total petulant teenager. But if you notice, when she tickles him, he actually laughs and smiles because he likes it. Like, he sort of like, he does like, he kind of simultaneously like wants her to stay because it feels good, but knows that she needs to go because that's the right thing to do.
Yeah. Well, and then it's also being something to be said about, you know, being a teenager and working through those things of being in this in-between of childhood and adulthood where it's like, yes, maybe he does like those things, but he knows in his mind he can't because he needs to grow up. And so, it's having that battle. Like, where is it right? Where's the in-between?
Yeah.
And he's kind of there through the whole movie.
Yeah, no.
I mean, that's the mood of that character through the whole picture kind of feels like there.
Yeah, I was always intrigued by these moments of, like, how do you know when you need to start using deodorant? Like, when you're a kid, you don't think about it. It kind of needs, and then like maybe like you start to go through puberty, your body changes, and like your body odor increases to the point where someone needs to make a suggestion to you, or you need to just understand it from the way that other people are speaking around you, and then you need to ask like, hey, like, mom, like, can I use some deodorant?
Can
take me to a place where I could buy some of this deodorant? And I was interested in like these sort of like never spoken about but well-known like thresholds that we have to like cross, and it's actually because we're changing in a very subtle gradated way, but there are moments where we need to start using deodorant, or there are moments where you need to stop fucking tickling me.
Yeah.
And like, and those sort of like moments where it builds up and then it's just like break.
Yeah.
Are interesting to me.
Well, and a conversation that you and I had too of like being able to portray that, but not showing it in a way of, God, mom, you fucking suck. Like, everything about this, I hate. Like, we didn't want to turn him into a dickbag teenager. And, like, I think that there was a very fine line of being very poignant of, no, mom, this is what I want, and then also kind of dancing around that to not be that person.
Well, I remember doing, like, a lot of takes of this line, like, I really don't want you here, when he's kicking her out of this shack, and, like, let's do one like you... like you like just wanted to get out of your hair. Let's do one like you, like, I want you to say that you love her with these words.
Yeah.
I want you to tell her that it's going to be okay with these words, and like tried a bunch of different like ways to inject that line with more compassion.
Yeah.
So when you met Logan, when you had the conversation, I mean, 35-year-old that he is.
Yeah.
I mean,
seasoned.
He's my senior.
Seasoned actor.
Well, you don't hear... I mean, I've spoken to a lot of young actors over the years, and some of them are very intellectual, and some of them are all kinds of things, but you seem to be very kind of like easily in touch with the idea of the emotional arc of portraying a character, which I don't hear from a lot of young actors as a rule. They're there in some other way. I mean, was this something that connected with you right away? Did you see that in him? In terms of knowing he would be able to do this?
The thing that struck me about Logan is that it seemed like he naturally occupied the emotional space that I wanted the story to take place in. That I wouldn't have to, like, try to explain the world to him and what was kind of darkly humorous about it and what was terrifying about it. That he just sort of like woke up and he was in that world. So it would make my job a lot easier, and I could trust him a lot more to make the right decisions about how to play that. Whereas, like many other actors I've met, like I felt like they were in another world. I don't know how better to describe it. Yeah.
Well, I think kids who are kid actors are, you know, they're playing more. Mm-hmm. They're not, you know, they're not figuring out the beats and all that stuff quite as much. Mm-hmm. But then they become adult actors. They have to change their, you know, they usually figure out craft.
It's not as simple though as saying like, I believe that like this person is naturalistic and this person is not. It's like, because there's different types of naturalism. Like I met some other natural actors, but I felt like I sort of felt like this world is like darkly humorous, and I felt like Logan got that right away. Whereas like it could be read just totally straight and like all drama, and I wanted to lean it away from that.
And for you, was this experience, you know, game changer, or I assume you don't get a lot of scripts that are this complex?
Yeah, no, I mean, judging from my past career and whatnot, I mean, it was something that was intricate based off of the emotionality of the entire thing. I mean, this wasn't a movie where I was like, oh shit, how am I gonna do this monologue or something like that? But it was the betrayal of the coming of age of this kid, but not coming of age, because I know you don't want it to be a coming of age.
No,
it's the dark humor spin on some coming of age film. And so, yeah, I mean, what I look for in movies that I want to do and that I hope that I get to do are ones that are challenging an audience and also just very different. I'm also like living in this kind of same format, but also changing the game in a little bit, in a stance. And so I definitely saw that with this movie and this script, and I read this and was like, you know, this is very unique. This is something that I've never like thought of before, but it's also something very close to home. And so seeing that and being able to play with that made it very refreshing. And I think coming out of this, I mean, it's interesting because every job you do, I always think, is a catalyst into something else. And, you know, this made me realize what exactly it is I want to do and where I want to go in my career, and kind of having this fine line with like messing and toying with dark humor while also having these stories that are very relatable, but can kind of change the way you think in a way of the situation. So it was a definite game changer. And now that it came to Sundance and we got it all done and it's a beautiful film and we didn't screw it up in editing, like, hell yeah, I'm so excited, you know? What could be better?
I won't show you the five cuts that we threw out before this one.
Right, yeah. There's a 5-hour one that I think is really, really great.
Really slow, but good.
Yeah.
So have you
one take too?
One, just all in one take? Yeah, I like that idea.
There was
the
like Birdman
version
where the beginning was quite a lot longer. It was a lot of like really long one takes.
We were toying around on what the name of the movie would be. I wanted to be eating off these leftovers, but
from Cindy's line,
yeah.
Eating off these or don't scare the horses.
That line, that's a good one.
Like that line got cut. Yeah.
Yeah, or dinner is not called supper.
Yes.
Yeah.
All of these would be higher on the Netflix queue than Take Me to the River, I'm not sure about their.
Yeah, so if anybody needs me in their marketing, I'm trying to get a title for their film, call me, okay?
And you wouldn't have a documentary relatively recently that the same title.
Oh, right.
Right.
Which I ran
That's
into
true.
Yesterday.
I'm sorry, I don't know what you're referring to.
Take Me to the what?
We found out about that documentary after.
Okay.
It is a different river, although this river is actually a tributary to that river, technically
Very
speaking.
True.
We found out about that after we had already gone through a huge title search, And I was so tired at that point of thinking of titles that I just asked for, you know, some opinions if anyone thought that they would be confused. And nobody said that they thought they would be confused with each other. So we stuck with it.
And the Johnny Knoxville Don't Scare the Horses will be coming out soon, I'm sure.
Yeah.
It's a whole different kind of movie.
Right.
Really,
right.
You know exactly what happened with those horses.
It's a balls out hoot and holler.
Also, yes, it's Zoo 2.
Paramount Pictures presents.
A lot of grease involved. Yeah. So are you excited? Just the actual thing of going to Sundance? Is that the...
Yeah. I mean, this is my first time. Had a short film that went there about 2 years ago, but I was only in it, and I didn't write it, direct it, or anything. So I was like, it's not my game to go. But yeah, it's a big one for me because this year I've got Take Me to the River and... Stanford Prison Experiment, which is really cool. And
which is at Sundance also or not?
Yes, it's at Sundance in the dramatic competition. So, and it's really great too. It's a very appropriate and exciting year because not only do I have two films, one of my best friends has two films, and my other best friend has two films, and we're these three people that have always kind of worked together in a force, and it's just really great and refreshing to see my friends also succeeding while I can as well, and we all can, you know. So it's been good.
So you won't just be the it boy, you'll be like the it fruit.
Oh no, I'll be the it boy. This shit's all about me.
You just reminded me.
I mean, they're great, but fuck them, right? Like,
My old roommate, whose name is actually Ryder, who I stole his name for this, we would always talk about when we were feeling down and like we were waiting for our break, that like maybe, you know, in a perfect world, that like they would talk about like this period where we lived together.
Right.
Like this would be the photographs of like us living here. Maybe like could be shown on like some some like biography something later.
Yeah.
Just to get ourselves cheered
and now
up
it can
about
be.
Being failures.
Yeah.
And now you're free, and you're equally joyous about going to the snow or non-snow.
Is there snow?
Apparently there's not any rain.
Oh, you didn't get the memo. Yeah, there's Fuck. It's cold.
It's not that cold.
It's Park City, Utah.
19 Not. Degrees at night.
Oh!
Take a sweater. Take two. So,
I get it. God, I gotta get changed. I got Speedos. That's all I fucking
need. Yeah. Not,
you go to the gifting
Florida.
Suites. It's okay.
Damn it.
Utah.
Gifting suites will set you right up.
That's good. Yeah.
I'm like, I it sounds like really cheesy, but I've been waiting for this like for so long that I don't really even know like how to feel about it. Like I started going to Sundance when I was 13. My parents would, we went as a family trip, just to watch movies. The first movie I ever saw at a film festival was Memento, in the library theater.
Nice.
And when I was 13, 2001. So, this will be like a very nice full circle for me. It's just a lot to process.
Yeah.
Do you know where you're premiering?
At the library. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so I will,
yeah,
like,
full circle.
I'll be sure to tell that story there that night, a week from yesterday.
Yeah. Christopher Nolan, eat your heart out.
No doubt Chris Nolan will be there to celebrate with you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I sent him an email.
He hasn't replied to me yet.
We
had a great dinner with Chris, and we said, listen, Chris, we want to do exactly what you're doing. He goes, shh, hush my son. He said to me, hush my son. Don't worry, it's going to work out better than you even imagined. And this guy is going to do the new
remake of this in 3D.
Well, you know, this movie actually is what Interstellar is about. Nobody knows about it, but this is the subtext of Interstellar, is your movie.
About how love can escape a black hole?
Yep.
Yes, of course. If you really understand what going to the library is in that movie, it's about you being at his premiere of Memento all those years ago.
He was speaking to me
through... Wow. Through Matthew McConaughey.
Guys, yeah. I think we just...
Well, I was, I was wondering if maybe like growing up, like, you know, when I was taking to filmmaking, if he was actually speaking to me that whole time.
If any YouTube editors or anybody wants to intercut Take Me to the River with Interstellar, you will be
open.
Yeah, you will have your mind expanded, and you'll be able to answer all the questions of life.
And you do look like a young Ellen Burstyn. So.
Oh yeah, thank you.
Yeah,
it all comes together.
There's corn in both.
There's corn.
Cornfields. Yeah.
Oh yeah, there's corn.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, you didn't even realize. You actually have a plagiarism suit, I think.
Also, Casey Affleck is in both as well. Casey, you could only see a very slight piece of in Take Me to the River.
He's actually in a reflection in a window,
yeah.
I believe.